This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you. What is a podcast? God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib Khan with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast. And I am here today with Max Larena. Max, could you introduce yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm Maximilian Larena. I'm called Max for short. And I'm affiliated with the Human Evolution Program of Upsala University. I'm originally from the Philippines. So I was born and grew up in the Philippines and studied university studies and did my medical degree in the Philippines and then went to Australia for PhD then transferred to Sweden for research career. Yep.
Yeah, that's great. So I assumed you were from the Philippines, partly by the topics of the papers that we're going to be discussing, and just for the listeners, I will just call them out right now. Multiple migrations to the Philippines during the last 50,000 years in PNAS. That one came out a little while ago. There's actually another paper related to the Philippines that I also think came out by another group at a similar time. And then more recently, the reason I reached out to you, Philippine Ita possess the highest level of Denisovan ancestry in the world. So the second, is a result I'm not entirely surprised by, but you really did some deep digging and kind of analyzed it in the greatest detail that I've seen so far. But let me first start with the initial paper. So this paper came out, I think it came out in the spring, like mm-hmm. March 2021. And so multiple migrations to the Philippines. I think a lot of listeners, they will have read various articles in the last, say, like 5 years about the Austronesian migration. There used to be the idea of a slow boat and express train out to the Pacific with the Polynesians. And where did it all begin? And the hypothesis that is currently, I would say it's dominant right now, is that the Ami, the Aboriginal people of Taiwan who speak Austronesian languages and in fact are still present in Taiwan in the mountainous east of the island. The current Taiwanese president is her fourth Aboriginal. So these are Austronesian people. And the hypothesis is on the order of, say, 3,000 to 4,000 years ago, they began to spread out of Taiwan, go southward, first go into the Philippines. And then from the Philippines, there's two different major streams. One stream goes west into island Southeast Asia, maritime Southeast Asia, leading to the Javanese, the Malays, all these other Austronesian-speaking groups. And then another stream goes eastward into the Pacific, skirting northern New Guinea and outward and becoming the Polynesians. So your paper kind of complicates that. Ultimately, like you say it in the title, but really it seems to kind of refute, I guess, that simple model. It's more complicated, right? Can you talk about that?
Yeah, sure. You presented it well. So most scholars would agree that the first modern human inhabitants in the region, like Southeast Asia, are the Australasian related groups, like the Philippine Negritos, the ancestors of Philippine Negritos. It's more controversial or disputed when it comes to the next wave of migrants. So there's two competing theories. One, it's either the next wave of migrants came from the north, the out of Taiwan or Austronesian expansion, which was espoused by Peter Bellwood way back before in the late 80s and early 90s. And it's, as you've said, it's a predominant view currently. And it's mainly based on linguistic analysis and some archaeological data. On the other side of the coin is the out of Sunda hypothesis that some groups migrated from south to the north into the Philippines from Sunda, which was a large continent way back before. This was espoused by Wilhelm Solheim and was modified later by Stephen Oppenheimer which is, he wrote a book about it, Out of Eden, like because of the geological changes during the end of last glacial maximum in Sundaland, and the subsequent inundation of Sundaland led to the migration of different groups into different directions. So what we did, I mean, there are like earlier genetic studies, but these are limited and it only covered like few ethnic groups in the Philippines and Indonesia. And some of it are only looking at uniparental markers. So what we did is to do a larger study.
Hey Max, can you tell the listener what a uniparental marker is?
So uniparental markers is either the mitochondrial DNA or Y chromosomal DNA. So it's something that's inherited from your mother or from the maternal side or paternal side. So this is only looking at one locus. But when you say autosomal DNA, you're looking at the entire genome. And yes, so that's in all chromosomes. It can either be full genome sequences, like everything, or some sites in a genome called single nucleotide polymorphism, which are known to be different between different individuals or different populations. And what we look at are the autosomal DNA, which is around 2.3 million SNPs, what we call SNPs. Is that?
That's good.
Yep. And yes, so yeah, this time we covered as much as I mean, a lot of ethnic groups all throughout the Philippines. And this was made possible with a partnership with the official heritage body of the Philippines, the National Commission for Culture and the Arts, as well as a lot of local institutional partners and some indigenous partners as well. So in the initial study, there were around 150, and even to the second study, it reached to 118 ethnic groups. And anyway, so what we found out is that there's actually a complex waves of migration. And what we see that is that there's first two waves of Australasian related Negritos, the Philippine Negritos. We divide them into Northern Negritos and Southern Negritos. They're very different from each other. So the Northern Negritos would include like the Aita, the Agta, Manide. They're different names. And the Southern Negritos, predominantly the Mamanua, which is more related to Australians and Papuans. So there's two corridors entering the Philippines, like going through Palawan, Mindoro, and to the north, and the other ones to the Sulu Archipelago, Sambanga Peninsula, to the major island in the south called Mindanao. So that's where likely the Southern Negritos entered. And these Negritos are, we think, it's still currently under analysis. They are also genetically related to other Negritos in mainland Southeast Asia, such as the Malay Negritos and the Thailand Negritos, or Thai Negritos, called the Mani ethnic group of southern Thailand, as well as the Andaman Island.
I want to ask you about that because there was a paper. I think it's not quite 10 years old yet. Maybe it's like from 2012 out of David Reich's lab.
Yep.
And that paper claimed that the Negritos of interior Malaya and the Andamanese, and so, you know, just when you say Negritos, I guess like the listeners, they should know these are dark-skinned people, dark-skinned people with tended curly hair, and they tend to live on these islands or isolated areas of Southeast Asia, and they descend from probably the indigenous substrate of Southeast Asia before the arrival of, this is the theory, and I think you kind of problematize this in terms of perhaps overturning it, of rice farmers from Southeast Asia. They were overwhelmed eventually. And so in the Reich paper, from what I recall, there were two deep branches of Negritos, Western and Eastern. And the Filipinos are with the Eastern. And the Filipino Negritos are in a clade with Australo-Papuans, as you would say in your papers, whereas the Negritos of the Andamanese, the Malayans and the ones in southern Thailand, they're in a separate clade. I mean, do you find something different in your analyses? I mean, this is a fascinating topic, so I really want to know that.
That's okay, yeah. We haven't gone that far with regards to the relationship of Andaman Island Negritos, but I assume that that's what you explain is the expected one. Yeah, that the Philippine Negritos is more related to Australopapuans. So there's this basal Sunda population in Sundaland that split later on, going to into the Philippines and into Australia and Papua.
Okay. Yeah. So go on. I'm sorry. I interrupted you.
It's okay.
About
it's okay. Yeah. It's okay. Yeah. So those are the first two waves of migration. And just to let the listeners know that the Philippine Negritos, they're actually very diverse groups of ethnic groups of, and it's around 30 to 36 Negrito populations within the Philippines, and each of them has their own distinct language. And these are very distinct language because they are like primary branches of, some of it are primary branches of Malayo-Polynesian branch of Austronesian language family, which is the main language of most of Southeast Asia. And when you say that, it's something like the distance between a Russian and an English-speaking person. So it's very different between different Negrito mm-hmm. languages. Yep. And aside from that, yeah, after some time, what we find is that there's also the subsequent waves of migration, which we refer to as the Manobo-related population going into the southern Philippines, into Mindanao. And the next wave is the Sama-related populations, which are an ancestry that is found predominantly among the Sama Sea Nomads of southwestern Philippines. And distinctively, this particular genetic ancestry is affiliated with some Austroasiatic-speaking ethnic groups in mainland Southeast Asia, such as the Hitin and Malabiri ethnic groups. And when we look at split times between Aboriginal Taiwanese and Northern non-Negritos called Cordillerans, it's around 12 to 15,000 years ago, which around the time there were changes in the region, which we associate with perhaps it's the geological changes during that time and the inundation of Sundaland, which precipitated the migration of these ethnic groups into multiple directions. And because the islands become isolated, they become differentiated into different ancestral populations. That's the thing. And the last major wave of migration, the fifth major wave of migration, are what we term as Cordilleran-related groups, which is an ancestry that we find mostly among Austronesian-speaking populations all throughout the Asia-Pacific region. And interestingly, the divergence time as well, when we estimate it, not only us, but also a paper by Jeremy Schwann from the Institut Pasteur et al., which we are also part of, it's around at least 7,000 to 8,000 or older between Aboriginal Taiwanese and the Cordillerans. And so this would indicate that this would precede the concept of people moving together with agriculture and language, because the evidence for agriculture is much more recent, like 4,000 to 5,000 years ago. And it's we don't see as a single pulse event as well. We don't see a north to south unidirectional movement or a monolithic block, but instead multiple pulses, because the admixture dates that we have, the oldest date is found all throughout the archipelago, not from north to south, but quite scattered. So it's very difficult to make sense out of it. So it seems to be a complex pulses of migration going into the Philippines. And we have to take note that there's also geological changes happening between 12 to 7,000 years ago in the landmass that connects Taiwan and southern China. And again, because of these changes, maybe perhaps this precipitated populations to move in different directions. And hence, we have diverse ethnic groups found in the Philippines. Yes. And there are minor migrations later on, which are the Papuan-related ancestry, which is like Papuan groups also migrating westward into eastern Indonesia and into southeastern Philippines. We think that this also happened at the same time when Papuan-related groups migrated eastward into Vanuatu or into Oceania. And there's also South Asian gene flow into some some ethnic groups in southwestern Philippines, which happened around 1,000 years ago, and then some limited Spanish colonial legacy in less than 1% of the population.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, let me. Yeah, I mean that was great, Max. Let me summarize the stage a little bit for the listener. So a lot of listeners are going to be American. They obviously know where the Philippines are. They probably know Filipinos personally. Mm. One thing that I think surprises a lot of us Americans, though, is there is no real ethnic group, I guess, maybe that's Filipino. There's a lot of different ethnic groups in the Philippines from the different islands, from Luzon to the north. So you're talking about the Cordillerans. They are in the northern interior. Mm-hmm. And then there's obviously Mindanao, where there's the Moro Muslim minority, yep. where there's a lot of political things. But then there's other islands like Palawan. There's a variety of islands where people are from these different islands. When I, lived in California, people would say, yeah, I'm from the Philippines and my family's from this island. So there's a lot of distinctiveness in these localities that I think a lot of us forget. And also the Philippines, I think one way, a stylized fact that maybe, outsiders, I'm thinking particularly Americans and Westerners can think of is, when the Spaniards arrived on Manila Bay, in the 16th century, the Philippines was already on the edge of the Austronesian Malayan world. Mm. There were already Muslims in Luzon, and there were already Sanskritic loanwords in the various languages of the Philippines. So it's part of this whole maritime Southeast Asian landscape united by Austronesian languages. Mm-hmm. And obviously the Philippines took a different cultural trajectory. It is a predominantly Roman Catholic country because of centuries of Spanish colonialism. If we had an alternative history and the Spaniards never arrived, I think the Philippines would probably the same thing that happened to the Philippines that happened to Malaysia and Aceh first, and then later to Java, and eventually was happening to the Austronesian speaking Chams in Southeast Asia and Cambodia. I think they probably would have become part of Islamic maritime Southeast Asia, but obviously that didn't happen. Mm-hmm. And so we think of the Philippines as very distinct, and it is religiously, but I think the broader cultural matrix is this Austronesian maritime Southeast Asian world. Now, your paper complicates a simple narrative of southward expansion on the order of 2,500 years ago, triggered by rice. You're introducing all sorts of other possibilities because of these divergences you're talking about. I want to repeat, this will be in the show notes for the listener, but I think I want to just repeat like these populations you're talking about. So we have one clade of, say, Northeast Asians, and you start out in your graph on the left with the Cordillerans, who are this northern Filipino group in Luzon, and then next to them in the clade you have Amis, who are Taiwanese indigenous populations, you say separated on the order of 8,000 years ago, and then next to them you have the Dai, which are a South Chinese group, highlands of southern China, and then of course the Han of northern China. This looks like the separations on the order of 10,000 years ago. There are some lateral gene flows from various other groups. Further out you have the various Austronesian groups. Then finally the Northern, East Asian groups and the indigenous Americans. So, I think that fits our intuition. So you are saying here, if I get you correctly, in this paper that, the expansion of populations that are more similar, Northeast Asians, kind of like lineages descended from maybe what we would say, listeners on this podcast will know, the sample from Tianyuan, 40,000 years ago, right? This happened considerably before the spread of agriculture into Southeast Asia. So are you asserting here, that, perhaps the, interaction between the, indigenous, I don't want to say Australo-Melanesian, although that's the term I think Bellwood uses. But basically, the earlier populations that are ancestrals and Negritos, and what we think of as the rice farmers, actually predates the rice farmers being rice farmers. Like, is that the implication here, that the Austroasiatic people were pushing into Southeast Asia before they were agriculturalists?
Yes, that's what we think. And even not only the Austroasiatic people into Southeast Asia, but also the Austronesian speakers, or maybe there's a pre-Austronesian language arriving in the Philippines. So we also think that the first, earliest Cordillerans in the Philippines were hunter-gatherers. And yeah, there are multiple evidence can support this. I think I enumerated in this paper, but there are recent publications that are nice as well. So one is an archaeological analysis that was done by Xiao Chun, dates around 7 to 5,000 years ago in the area around southern China and coastal Vietnam. Her analysis is that most of these populations are actually hunter-gatherers. The second thing is that analysis on rice genetics, the demographic spread of rice, which is the main component of the Bellwood or out of Taiwan hypothesis, which was published last year and this year by, last year was by Rafael Gutaker and this year by Ornob Alam. Both of these are from Michael Puroganan, who is a rice expert. So what they found is that the indigenous rice in northern Philippines is actually coming from Indonesia, and that split more than 3,500 years ago. And the indigenous rice in Taiwan is a combination of rice from mainland Asia or China, like the temperate rice, and rice coming from northern Philippines. So it's the opposite direction. So yeah, it's complex as well in terms of the spread of farming. It's more recent in terms of the spread of rice paddy field agriculture, and it's way after the movement of people.
Yeah, I'm still, finding out that Clovis first was wrong. Like, I can accept it, but it's hard to integrate it in my mind about what's going on, because I associate it mentally with the Bellwood hypothesis so closely. Yeah. And I thought it had been, pretty much validated. I mean, what has been the reaction when the peer reviewers saw this, and just in the academic community among archaeologists and whatnot?
Yep. Yeah. I didn't have any problems with Filipino archaeologists as well as Taiwanese archaeologists. I mean, I visited various museums in Taiwan, and even in the museum, they would post, they would explain the out of Taiwan. But there's a note that this is not what we see given the local evidence. Yes, and most archaeologists that I spoke to wouldn't dispute this. And maybe it is a different story when talking to linguists, but I think I'm not sure on how would they view this one. And I think there will be increasing number of evidence in the future. The thing is, there's a lack of archaeological data to really have a more meaningful analysis. And it's a sampling bias, and I think in the future there will be more, and which would either likely support or dispute this one, and or add more complexity to this one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, so I want to talk about the Cordillerans, who so I think that they're unique, and they're important in a way because of this to the next paper as well. They have almost no Negrito ancestry.
Yep.
And so they probably arrived in the Philippine Islands about 8,000 years ago, 6,000 BC, they show up, and somehow they remain totally separated from the Negrito people.
Yes. That's something strange for us. They're in more or less an isolated area in the mountains, in the Cordillera Mountains of northern Philippines. And strangely, I don't know what's the reason, how come for a long time they remain least admixed or added mixed with Philippine Negritos. And yes, there's only some of the groups that's outside of Cordillera Mountains, which are also Cordilleran related populations, have signs of admixture with Negritos, but not the ones that are really in the mountains. Like, there's six groups that I enumerated: Tuali, mm-hmm. Ayangan, and Ibaloy, mm-hmm. and Tangkanay. Yep. And I think this was also, I mean, presented way back before by Pontus Koglun on the Lapita paper. They find that, they only have one Cordilleran there, the Kankanae Cordilleran. They also find it like, they didn't find any Papuan-related ancestry. Because the Lapita, the first Lapita individuals, these are 2,900 to 3,000 years old and hardly has any Papuan-related ancestry. So, I think way back, like more than 3,000 years ago, to 8,000 years, there's a lot of populations that are unadmixed or less admixed. And it's a bit random when populations admix. We sometimes assume once one population arrives in an area, they are expected to admix right away or in a few hundred years. But in some cases, like in the case of Cordillerans, it's been, I mean, more than 5,000 or at most 8,000 years ago. They still admix.
Yeah, it's fascinating. It's kind of a mystery. Before we move on to the next paper, so two things. The Cordillerans, they do not have any gene flow from Northeast Asian or Northern Northeast Asians, right? So there's this model now presented by the ancient DNA work of Chiamei Fu and her group and other groups that there's kind of like a deep structure between Northern and Southern Northeast Asians. Mm. And there's like a massive gene flow that occurred in kind of modern Han Chinese or they're kind of like the products of the middle. Right. Yep. I guess what I'm saying there is the Cordillerans, they don't have any Northern Northeast Asians. So they're purely Southern East Asian. And are they the most, I'm going to say pure of those lineages in your data set?
Yeah, you can say that. Yeah, I think a lot of people also tried to, borrow it and analyze it. Yeah, it seems like, and we are still analyzing our data together with the ancient DNA data by Xiaomei Fu, which is a very good paper. And so it's more affiliated with Southern East Asians, what they call as Southern East Asians, those example, the Liangdao individuals, which are around 7,000 to 8,000 years old. We also have those samples. Yes, and even in those individuals, when we analyze the Liangdao individuals, they have some amount of Northern East Asian ancestry, but we don't find it in Cordillerans.
Okay, I mean, I guess it kind of makes sense if they arrive, 8,000 years ago, it's before the Great Exchange and the gene flow and agriculture. And so before we move on to the Denisovan paper, which is why I reached out to you, but then I reread the Philippine paper and I was like, I got to talk about this because,
thanks.
I think, honestly, I did read that paper, but part of me was just like, wait a second, but wait, out of Taiwan was so simple.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm like, oh, you're adding way too much complication into my mental models right now.
Yeah.
Are you thinking that the Cordillerans then were essential in the Austronesian expansion, or how do we think of that right now?
For population geneticists, I think they are very good surrogate of the least admix signal for Austronesian expansion because they hardly, we don't find Negrito ancestry or Northeast Asian ancestry. So, yeah, they're quite significant in terms of, analyzing comparative that data.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Let's move to the second paper. So the Atia people have the highest level of Denisovan ancestry. This was kind of suspected and evident, though not as robustly, like about 10 years ago. Before we talk about the Denisovans, which have been an obsession of mine over the last 3-4 years, partly because I think they're way more interesting in a lot of ways from a population genetic perspective than Neanderthals, but I'll get to that later. Tell us about the Aitia, A-Y-T-A. Like, who are these people and, where are they situated?
So, the Philippine Negritos have different names. There's what you call Aita, Agta, Ata, Ati. So, and the Aita are mostly situated in Central Luzon, which is in southwestern part of Luzon Island, And there are also different Aita groups like Aita Ambala, Aita Magbukon, and these two groups happen to have one of the highest Denisovan ancestries. And phenotypically, they are shorter and have curly hair and dark skin, and that's why they are termed as Negritos way back before. And just also to emphasize, because sometimes when I present, some people would ask me if it's politically correct to call them Negritos. When I visited these communities, I mean, when I ask them, is it fine to call you Negritos? They own the term. They are proud to be Negritos. They find nothing wrong with having a dark skin or being called Negritos. And yep.
Mm-hmm. And I have a question. I have a question. Because I did read a little bit about the Aitas before I talked to you. And you know, I'd known about them before, but it says some of them have light hair. Is that correct?
What do you mean light hair? Like
a non-black hair color, like
No, they're quite
you never saw any of those people with light hair. Okay.
Nope. Maybe you're referring to the sea nomads. Some sea nomads, some have a bit of light or almost blonde hair.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Mm. All right. Anyways, go on.
Yes, and the Aita Magbukon is located in Bataan, and yes, there's only few thousands of Aita Magbukon, and what is known like way back before, like 10, 11 years ago, the initial papers were David Reich. They have a Philippine Negrito group included in the analysis, and that's the Mamanwa, which has much more lower Denisovan ancestry. So the focus mm-hmm. of where Denisovan ancestry is found is in Papua, among Papuans and Australian Aborigines. But this one, yeah, we included a lot more populations, and these are populations who are more into the remote areas of the Philippines. And yeah, and we just so happen to find that some of them actually has very high Denisovan ancestry. And the thing that the advantage I think that we can do in our study is that we have different Negrito groups, and we can actually correlate or plot the Denisovan ancestry relative to Negrito ancestry, and we can extrapolate how would a pure or least admixed Negrito would look like, how much Denisovan ancestry they would have. And we did that, and it can be up as high as up to 46% or 50% Denisovan ancestry relative to Papuans or Australian Aborigines, and that's pretty high.
Yeah, yeah. So this Denisovan ancestry. So let's, I want to remind some listeners of what's going on with these Denisovan. I mean, everyone knows. I mean, if you're listening to my podcast, you know, I hope you know about Denisovans, and if you don't, you're a very ignorant person. No, I'm just joking. So let me just refresh. These are East Eurasian hominins, East Eurasian humans that are related to Neanderthals, that split off from Neanderthals after an early out of Africa migration, perhaps between 600,000 to 750,000 years ago. After this, they separated from Neanderthals. And Neanderthals show a phenomenon in the ancient DNA where they tend to be closely related. They go through these population bottlenecks, and then they seem to re-expand. And so there are multiple different Neanderthal populations in the temporal transect, but any given time, it looks like there's generally one Neanderthal population from the Altai to Spain. Denisovans are different. It looks like there's deep structure that continues over time mm-hmm. in different regions. There's deeply different Denisovan clades. Like some of them might be as old as like split 400,000 years ago from each other, which is deeper actually than the deepest split in modern, like by probably about twofold than the deepest split in modern humans. And so you have like Denisovans that were definitely in the Altai, obviously. And these Denisovans look like to have contributed most of the low level of Denisovan, very low level, like 0.1% area of Denisovan ancestry in Northeast Asians, mainland Northeast Asians. There's different group of Denisovans that seem to have contributed to the ancestry in the Papuans, who are about like on the order of 5% Denisovan. And I mean, I think the South Asian Denisovan ancestry in the Indian subcontinent is more like the Papuans, but that could be different. Now, the Philippine ones, the admixture into the Ita, you are definitely claiming is distinct from the Papuan ones, because you do have Papuan, Australo-Papuan gene flow into the southern part of the islands, and it's not correlated with that. Mm. Can you talk a little bit about it? Can you talk about Browning's method and the S method and how they used, you know, how you guys used cutting edge genomics to figure out all these differences with track lengths and the matches to the ancient genome samples?
Yep. Yes. So what we find among Philippine Negritos is that the evidence that we enumerated in the paper, how come we think that it's an independent event. One is that when you make a correlation between Denisovan versus Australasian ancestry, so either Papuan or Negrito ancestry, it falls outside the slope of Papuan-related groups, like ethnic groups that has Papuan-related ancestry, such as Eastern Indonesians and Oceanians. That's one, indicating it's likely a different one. And they have, as we mentioned, they have higher Denisovan ancestry, and this is not accounted for the dilution. It can be explained because Papuans might have admixed with other populations that diluted their ancestry, but we don't know of any evidence that the Highlander Papuans admixed recently with other populations with low levels of Denisovan ancestry. It's the contrary. It's the Philippine Negritos who have admixed with East Asian migrants or Cordilleran-related populations who have almost undetectable levels of Denisovan ancestry. And then we also tried to do an explicit population topology called an admixture graph. And when we try to model it, if it's a shared or a single event in the ancestor of Australopapuans and Philippine Negritos, it's the model is rejected. What is not rejected is a model wherein there's a distinct or independent Denisovan introgression event into the Philippine Negritos. And lastly, we also did simulations, and we tried to model and see if the pattern of data that we observe among Philippine Negritos is supported by a shared event or an independent event. What we cannot rule out or what is supported is that either the ancestors of Philippine Negritos and Australopapuans receive a shared event way back before, and then the Philippine Negritos receive another Denisovan interrogation event. Perhaps the Papuans and the ancestors Papuans as well, based on Jacobs et al. Publication 2 years ago in Cell. And the thing is, maybe the ancestors Philippine Negritos have received much more impact in terms of the admixture. And then, or there's only a completely different Denisovan admixture in different islands. There's no shared admixture event way back in the past. So these are the two models. And then on how we measure the Denisovan ancestry, there are a couple of ways. And one is what we call F4 ratio statistics, or D statistics as well. So what you look at is more or less counting the alleles that are affiliated to the Denisovan, and it's also accounting for Neanderthal ancestry. So how much, it's more or less how much Denisovan ancestry accounting for Neanderthal ancestry. Because the presence of Neanderthal ancestry can confound the presence of Denisovan ancestry, because as you mentioned earlier, they are more related to each other than to modern humans. So you have to correct for that, and that's what we do. And the other method is by Sharon Browning, the S prime method, which looks, so you scan in the genome and look something that's very different from modern humans, so it's really deeply diverging, and these are assumed to be archaic segments, and then you try to compare these archaic segments to a reference genome like Denisovan and Neanderthal. Are they more Neanderthal? Are they more Denisovan? And then you can actually make a percentage similarity, like Is it 100% Denisovan, 80%? And when you say Denisovan, we're referring to the Altai Denisovan because it's the only genome, high coverage genome that we have available as of the moment. And what we see is that, the, as you mentioned, the mainland East Asians have a bit of the 80% similarity to the Altai Denisovan. But when it comes to Papuans and Philippine Negritos, there's more of the Denisovan that's only 50% similar, or 50 to 60% similar to Altai Denisovan, meaning they are more deeply diverging to relative to the Altai Denisovan. It was estimated around between 200 to 400,000 years ago of divergence. Yes, yeah, I think.
Yeah, so that was the, I mean, you know, the paper's open access, so you guys can read the paper. I know that this sounds like a mouthful. It's partly because, you know, we are revolutionizing our understanding, our conception of the human past, of the phylogenetic tree of, you know, archaic humans, you know, like our cousin lineages, along with the modern human origin itself. And so, you know, there's a lot of conceptual gaps to fill in. There's a lot of novelty here. And obviously, people are still discovering things along the way. So, you know, I guess at this point, Denisovans, we don't know. We don't have a species label for them because, you know, there's no fossil attached to them. But you do present something, a hypothesis, which just I immediately assumed when. Reading the title and knowing about this Homo luzonensis, you suggest could be a possibility. Talk about that. I'm assuming you know a little bit more about Homo luzonensis than the typical person listening. Tell us about Homo luzonensis and why you bring Homo luzonensis up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's just, I mean, having the data presented that there's a lot of Denisovan ancestry among Philippine Negritos, especially in the northern Philippines, like the Aita and the Agta, where the Homo luzonensis fossil was discovered. So the fossil was discovered in northeast Luzon, and it's in a Calao cave. And previously, it was the first one was dated to around 67,000 years ago, and the most recent paper. Some are 67, some are 50,000 years ago. This is uranium series dating. And what they find is that the fossil has a combination of archaic and derived morphological characteristics, which is a combination of archaic and modern human. So they made, based on that, they made a classification of a new species termed Homo luzonensis. So the thing is, as you mentioned, we don't know how Denisovans really look like. So we don't know if they are Denisovan related, or a completely different species. So what we suggest in the paper, there might be multiple archaic species, or they might be actually be related to Homo luzonensis. Yep.
So, I mean... Homo luzonensis obviously is found on Luzon.
Yep.
You know, in terms of ancient DNA on the Philippine Islands, so you guys got ancient DNA in your paper, I think your earlier paper, or you got ancient DNA from like coastal South China, like off Fujian, correct? Like across from Taiwan.
Yep.
And what are the prospects for more ancient DNA in the Philippines? Because it seems like a lot of your questions would be answered if you had more ancient DNA from Southeast Asia itself.
Yeah, that's true. I think, I mean, it's a challenging environment, tropical environment. It's difficult to have successful extraction of ancient DNA. But yeah, there's a publication with UMACOL, and they have one... data from northern Philippines from Nagsabaran, which is close to actually where the Homo luzonensis was found, but this is only dated to 1,900 years ago. And they tried with the Homo luzonensis fossil, but they were unsuccessful to extract ancient DNA. I hope they would try to do ancient proteome, and that's one of the bases where the Tibetan fossil was classified as a Denisovan. So yeah, that I don't know if they're doing it as of the moment, but I think it's still possible to extract ancient DNA if we have more fossils to analyze. And the other thing is as well is that we cannot, we also have to take into consideration doing analysis on sediments, and it's becoming more optimized recently that you can actually extract DNA from soil. So that's one possibility that can be done in the future, in future excavations.
Well, so, you know, Homo luzonensis, Homo floresiens, the Flores Hobbit, all of these are part of like a panoply of Southeast Asian human lineages that are deeply diverged. Seems like Southeast Asia was really specious. So are you presuming, and I'm sure it was in the paper and I may probably missed it, are you presuming that the admixture occurred in Luzon, or do you think maybe Homo luzonensis and, you know, I mean, Sundaland was big. So the whole, so just for the listener, the whole, the watery, you know, the oceanic area south of Thailand and Cambodia today, the presumption is much of it was, you know, woodland savanna during the Pleistocene when the sea level was lower. Like, could a lot of the genetic events that you are inferring have happened elsewhere and those populations migrated into the Philippines?
Yeah, you have a good, you're raising a good point. Like, maybe some of the archaeological sites that are very important is already submerged because of the inundation of Sundaland. So that will be an issue. But the thing is, I mean, the fossils that were discovered more recently is actually more inland. So there's still possibility. And there's a lot of cave networks, like where the Homo luzonensis was found, like it's only in one cave network. There's, I think, more than 100 or a lot more cave networks that's not yet been investigated. So there's still a possibility.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. I mean, it looks like there's still a lot of work to be done. So I mean, that's good for you, right?
Yeah, I think I hope that it's Florent Detroit from Musée de l'Homme and as well as Armand Mijares who are doing a very good job on this one. Yeah, they are the experts or the archaeologists. I hope that they will do more in the future. I'm sure they're doing something more.
Well, so I guess the last question I want to ask you about actually is to loop back to this Australo-Papuan migration. So, I mean, that Philippines is pretty far. These people, I mean, have you talked to archaeologists about what's going on with that? This expansion out of, you know, Melanesia to the west of the east? Because, I mean, you've already kind of implied that the simple model out of Taiwan rice agriculture is wrong. So these hunter-gatherers, these Southeast Asian hunter-gatherers who were originally located in what we call southern China today, spread out after the Pleistocene, and then rice agriculture came later. So I'm imagining a situation where they're interacting with the Hobinian indigenous people on the mainland, and then somehow they selectively picked up the rice agriculture where the Hobinians did not, and so the Negritos are these isolated relics. But we also have this situation with people moving out of the New Guinea. I mean, like, has anyone told you anything about like what's going on here? Are they like whatever, you know?
I think we will. I don't think earlier papers have described this phenomenon. Most of the earliest papers, like their interpretation of the Papuan related ancestry in eastern Indonesia, is that Papuan related populations were there. And then later on, Austronesian expansion is the opposite. But what we find is actually the opposite. I mean, the Papuan-related ancestry happened more recently, after the divergence of between Australians and Papuans. So, yeah. And if you talk to Sue O'Connor, who is an archaeologist in Australian National University, she would also argue for like a complex demographic movement of people in eastern Indonesia. It's not as simple as it seems.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So there's a lot more to be discovered, I think.
Yeah. Well, so, I mean, Max, thank you for your time. I mean, you know, I don't know if I should call you the destroyer of Southeast Asian orthodoxies or what, because I don't know what to think right now. That's fine. If what I thought in the past was false, but man, that was easier than what you're trying to like present here. Anyway, so what are you working on in the future? Like, let me ask you that before I let you go.
Yeah, this paper we sequence only few Philippine Negrito genomes, and I think it would be nice to have to sequence more so that it's possible to reconstruct what is an islander Denisovan. So you'll have more DNA tracks, and then yeah, you can actually cover it. As much as possible, the genome of a Denisovan within the Philippines. That's what we're hoping to do. And then, yeah, also in the future, like doing some ancient DNA work in the area.
Awesome. Awesome. Yep. Well, thank you for your time. The papers, again, for the listener, are in PNAS, Multiple Migrations to the Philippines During the Last 50,000 Years. It came out in March. It is open access. And then we also have the Philippine Aita possess the highest level of Denisovan ancestry in the world. Very descriptive. And then that just came out on the 12th, and that's in Current Biology, and that is also open access. So, you know, I described the figures a little bit to you guys, and, you know, this was a complicated publication, I have to say. So I'm sure that we said a lot of things that were confusing to you, but read the papers. They're there. They're open access. And I really appreciate Max just jumping on in short notice and, you know, giving of his time. Thank you, Max.
Thanks.
This podcast for kids. This